First of all, thank you for attending. I think it's a huge event, this one. I organized the CLS with Maria and another guy in Madrid, and see all these people together is quite nice. So just to introduce myself, that's me, Josè Manrique in Twitter. Nothing related with JavaScript. I love the web, but I don't do JavaScript that far. And the first community I've been participating a long time ago in the university was about how to use Linux and open source in open devices, in little devices on that time. So I ended in the MIMO community. Anyone here remember the MIMO community? I suppose the Intel guy remembers that. You know that. And from there I started to participate in the GNOME community and the Mozilla Hispano Mozilla community. I love the web as a platform to provide tools and the open source ecosystem and openness, and that's the thing. And I am an industrial engineer, nothing related with computer science, sorry, for the people that usually think that that's not a good idea, but I ended up working on what I love more, is working on open source, doing open source technology for open source projects. That's Vitergia, that's the company I work for in Spain. So I'm going to ask you a very easy question. What's a community? Anyone wants to answer? Well, usually the answer is a lot of people together with a personal interest on something in common, and that generates a community. That's easy to understand, right? The thing is, from my point of view, and don't take consumers' word as the people that buy something. It's the people that is interested in something. Maybe from the perspective of, I want to go there and learn about, well, skiing, or about technology, or about how to make beer at home because I want to drink better beer, or something like that. That's the starting point of a community. If you get a group of people interested in that, it's good to know. You can start by measuring that. But the important thing, I think one of the core people in the community is the people that wants to help you to make a better community, a better product, a better idea, a better topic. I want to improve this technology. I am participating in Mozilla, and in Mozilla in the beginning didn't have, for example, a Spanish translation. And it was, okay, let's go there, how to translate Mozilla into Spanish. Or I want to help, for example, in JavaScript, Angular, how to make it better, because it's not very good in my mobile, or things like that. And those people want to help you. And that's one of the best revenues of the community. You give one, and they give you 10. It's one of the things I have listened lately. And communities, the most important thing about communities, I want you to write that down, is about people. If you don't want to be hard, don't hurt anyone. That's easy for diversity or whatever discussion you have on mind. Think about you are treating with another people. Well, I suppose most of you maybe know this is Mozilla community meeting in Canada, which I did 3-5 years ago. This is the GNOME community meeting in Coruña, Spain, 2-3 years ago. And this is the CLS people in Portland last year. These are community managers. This is John Oikon. That's me. Okay, nice picture. I love that picture. But this is about people. These people discussing about this is my experience. Another thing that is important, communities are different, are diverse. Even inside, but you cannot compare one community to another community. There's a typical first mistake when you start thinking about, I want to measure how healthy is my community, and you start comparing with others. You start comparing, for example, .NET community against JavaScript community. They are very different. Their origin is very different. Whatever it is different. So they have to be different by themselves. But we can work on that later. Related with these people that wants to help you, I am most involved in open source communities. And for me, what's important about open source communities and about the people that is participating in these communities, they want to change how the things are being done. And it's very important. I want you just to point to two things I've been reading lately. It's about open development method. It's about how to develop technology in an open way. That's not inside my office, but outside my office, collaborating with other people, creating a community of cooperators. And the other thing is big companies that start to think about, okay, if three people together in a garage with 4,000 people in a community can beat me as a company with 2,000 people working together, maybe I'm doing something wrong. So I have to measure that internally or change how I work. That's inner sourcing, the approach about using open source and community mentality inside your company. And that's something very different from the outside and the ecosystem. So this is the kind of role that many of us has been seeing that has been appearing a lot in the market. In the community. One of the things about community leadership that I probably don't like that much, but it's important, is the leadership work. I used to participate in communities. When I say I am the leader, I'm not the leader, I'm part of a community. You cannot be the leader. Okay, someone has to take the first step, but you have to learn about delegate, about working with others. Again, it's about people. Maybe other people want to help you, so let them help you, because it's not you, it's the community, again, okay? So, but these people appear everywhere. The community help, the community manager, the real relation people, the evangelists, whatever. They are people willing to make communities work. The key responsibilities here are healthy, visibility, and productivity. Why? Because many, many technology and solutions depend on that technology that's been created by the community. The more healthy communities, the more visible communities, and the more productive communities are going to release the best products in the market. Or not. But probably, thanks to visibility, they are going to be very well known. You know that. I don't know how many of you, if you take, for example, JavaScript, how many of you do here knows about JavaScript frameworks? How many JavaScript frameworks do you think there are in the planet? Probably more than humankind people, okay? But for sure you know about AngularJS, or you know about jQuery, or you know about, I don't know, there are too many. But the well-knowns are very well-known, right? And if you have to rely on one of them, you are going to go for the well-known, right? Not for the ones that is developed by someone in Russia that is very good technically. But there is no community behind that, right? You know that. So when we talk about communities, first we have to think about what's about being open in a community. This discussion about diversity, about the size of the community, that's another point. The first point is about transparency. Make things visible. What's happening in your community? If you don't have any visible about what's happening, people are going not to trust too much on what's happening there. So for example, if you have a discussion about diversity, that's good, make it visible. Because then you can, for example, see that there's one troll. Trolls are everywhere, remember that. They are going to appear, whatever you talk about. I remember in Austin last year, we have a discussion about diversity, about women, and things like that. And I was like, okay, good. How many Spanish people are giving a talk in Austin? Spanish or, when you say Spanish, it's like, oh yes, you are Hispanic. No, Spanish people. For example, or Spanish, okay, let's go worse. How many Hispanic people, considering the average Hispanic people that is in USA? And you see that it's not that much. It's even worse than women, okay? So that's the diversity. So make it visible, the discussion. It's about participation. People want to do things. Let them do things for you. Help you, together, build something. That's important part. And collaboration. Okay, it's not only you and my sadness about I'm going to help this community, I'm going to be one of the community junkies here, and I'm going to say everywhere that I am helping this community. It's about working with other people to make something better. The product, the technology, the idea, the group, the people making friends, whatever. I love making friends in communities. So this is when you think about all of these things are being done openly, you can start thinking about what we can measure. And this comes from a blog we have posted in opensource.com, opensourceway.com, about five types of metrics you can measure so easily. For example, you can easily measure activity. What's activity? It doesn't matter what community you have. If you're some developer-oriented community, maybe you are going to measure things like how many commits, how many contributions, how many mails are being sent, that kind of thing, right? You can measure things about size. What's the size of a community? The size, I mean, okay, it's so big. It's usually that way, okay? It's about the performance, how you are performing in your community. For example, if you are not a consumer-oriented community, in terms of, okay, I'm not organizing meetups. Okay, how many people is coming from your meetups? How many meetups you are organizing? How many people are coming? Because your target is to get more people involved, so that's performance. But if you are, for example, a developers-oriented community. I mean, how many issues are being fixed? How many people is fixing issues versus the people that is submitting issues to your community? Or people that is submitting pull requests? Do you know the word pull request? Who doesn't know about pull requests? Oh, wonderful. In Spain, this is even worse. Okay, that demography. Demography for me is one of the key points here. It's about how many people, not that just usually this pyramid about demography, but how many people is still active in the community when the times advance? I mean, for example, when you started the hype about, I don't know, jQuery. Do you know jQuery? many people long time ago started using jQuery. Now it's the death. Everybody doesn't like it, but didn't like it, but again, still there for a long time. But when you say, okay, how many people is still active in that community 5 years later? Because we usually live in the hypes. We change hype to what hype, but communities just keep there. So that's the thing about how people are still there. Another thing is diversity. And that's the point, one of the points I like most from the previous talk is about diversity is not about men or women. It's about people from different points, from different organizations. How many people from different organizations are there? One of the things I love most here is that there's people from a lot of different, very different communities here, but also people from different areas of Italy. One of the fails I think we have in Madrid when we did the CLS Madrid was there were only people from Madrid. Well, one girl from London, but that was very nice. But the thing is, we want to grow and have other visions you need, because you can learn from that. You can measure that somehow. So that's the starting point, to understand what are the families of metrics you can play with. The second point is, what do you want to measure? And I will say something very clear now. Take care of what you measure, because you can make a lot of fails there. I think, for example, the first thing that people love more is what we call the first level metrics. Counting things is so easy. How many people do you have in your meta group? That's so easy. And what do you know the best thing? It always increases. It usually always increases. How many commits do you have in your product? That usually, that even best, always increases. So the number is very good always. You like people, marketing people like to say, okay, we have 10,000 contributors to our project. That's the easy thing. And you know that. It's very easy to cheat, because okay, how many commits? If you are a community manager and you start to provide transparency and visibility to things like, okay, we are measuring the number of commits, for example, or the number of answered emails, it's so easy to cheat. Instead of one big commit, provide five small commits, and you are going to be one of the leaders of the community. It probably is not true, but it's used. The second level of metrics are even more interesting. It's the evolution of the community itself. How, during the time, things are changing. Or what are the trends? Is people during this month is more active than the previous one? Is the people still active in the community? How is this year compared with the last year? And then you start to see things quite interesting about the evolution of the community and the health of the community. Because that's when health starts to appear as a term. Because having a lot of people is not that difficult. But keeping there is so easy. It's also much more difficult, sorry. And the third level of metrics is when you start to play with the data, as I usually say. It's when you start to cross between different metrics. For example, if you go to the, I don't know, that demography. I think someone told before people like, okay, you go there and you see who are the core developers of my project. Who are the people that is doing, for example, the 80% of the commit. And you will see that probably if you're project is so huge, it's that small. I think in America, they call them the boost factor. You know what the boost factor is? Who doesn't know what boost factor? Okay, it's the number of people you have to put, more or less. You have to put in a bus, throw the bus through the beach or whatever, or kill everybody, and all these people that made the project dead, because they are not going to contribute more to the project. And they are doing the 80% of the code. So you think about that. If you think, for example, I do a measure for Node.js, how many of you know Node.js? I'm pretty sure you think that's the more large community. I think it's 3,000 contributors during the last year. And you see that the boost factor is 16 people. You have to hit 16 people and the project is gone, no more. Because it's 80% of the code there, 80% of the knowledge. If you have to, you start to measure things about how these people evolves during time, or how was the activity, when do you become a regular or a core contributor, or someone that is answering the emails more than other people, then you start to play with things very interesting. And you can take very smart decisions there. For example, for hiring. You are in a company, your company has an open source project, and you need to hire someone for support. What would you do? The typical thing is you put an announcement somewhere about, we are hiring. very nice in all the websites. You go to a very huge process to select people for support, asking them how they know the product. You know that you have a forum, you can measure the people in the forum, you can measure how many people is answering questions in the forum that is not from your company, because I'm sure you have a list of the people of your company, they are answering also questions, and you can compare, okay, who are the people that are asking more, answering more questions in the right way? You can measure that, you know that, better than me, for sure. So that's the kind of things you can measure easily to learn about your community. And it's not about, okay, I have more people than you in other communities. It's about learn first from your community and take decisions based on that. Okay, so this is the first step. I need information. For a community manager or people, thank you very much for the time. And it's always run out of time, but I'm going as fast as possible. So the first thing is I need information. So one of the things I love most about nowadays is the information is outside, it's there. Even for what they call the offline communities, I don't know how many meetups groups are in Milan. How many? Do you know that? I can promise, in Madrid it's more than 200 or more. There are almost the same number of meetups than JavaScript frameworks, more or less. I'm going to finish like that. But you can go there, you can take the data, because again, transparency. If your community is open, if your community is transparent, one of the key points is everything should be there, should be consulted, could be play with that. But one of the things here is very funny. For example, there are people that is contributing in GitHub. Easy, you can go there and measure there. But those people are also participating in a mailing list for the same group, and also meeting in a meetup, and also probably asking questions in the Stack Overflow or Discord, right? And how to measure and profile all of them, that's hard, you know, because you have to learn who is these people in GitHub, working for this organization, answering questions here, and those are data silos. Someone has mentioned here about open data, okay, let's see if this happens here sometime. So usually the thing is, and this is very typical, when you start thinking about metrics, okay, let's go, let's measure. I'm a technical guy, probably more technical than me even. It's so easy. I go there, I put some scripts, and I start to extracting data, and okay, and have to mix this data with other data, and then this data with other data, and have to, I am measuring the right things? How to make that? So this is where we, as a company, as Bitergia, appears. We can help on that, because we have like 15 years experience and research about how to measure activity in open source communities, in open source software communities. So we started 3 years ago a company, like, okay, we are doing this in the academia, you know, papers, something like that, so boring. Well, we try to not be that boring nowadays, but we are still there. And the thing is, okay, well, if people want this, and Samsung came one day and said, okay, I want an analysis about transparency in the code review process in the WebKit. You know WebKit, what is? Well, okay, we want to participate here. And we know this is a project driven by Google and Apple. If a third company appears there, they are going to treat me fair? Imagine that, okay? So it's like, okay, if someone wants this as a company, why not building a company for that? So we have a set of open source tools, so you can play with them for free. Free open source tool, real free, open source, libre, whatever you want to say that. That gather the data, we play and match the data, we have some experience providing some queries, specific queries to get the answers to you, and provide some dashboards. That's the typical thing we provide to the market or to the customer, but one of the things is we provide also reports, specific reports for each community, because I said, each community is different. You cannot say, okay, I'm going to compare, and this is a very specific question I had some time ago, I want to compare the .NET community against the Java community, and I was like, okay, how to start. Okay, they are different. So you can play with it. I will try to show you two things. First of all, this is bitters.io. Sorry for the naming. It's a tool to get data from your GitHub repository. You have a GitHub, this is for free. Up to 10 repositories, you can get some data. And I'm going to show you some examples of the things we are providing. Okay, this is the website. If you have a GitHub account, you can play with it. But to see some example of kind of metrics we are providing, I think, well, do you know Rust? This language that Mozilla has developed as a real open source language for development. One of the things here, for example, I think is as we mentioned before. This is the worst factor, more or less. So if you go to there, indeed, they have like 1,004 people there, okay? 400 people there contributing. So this is the big number, the people that marketing loves more. But if you go downside, you see that the core people is 57 people. This is the people that are doing 80% of the commits. If you go here, you can see this is the typical also trend that everybody loves to see. How many commit people, authors I have there. But if you go downside, you can see how many new people you have there by month. That is even more interesting because it's how many people I am attracting. This is the typical things about trends. How is my community behaving now from last year, from last week, from last month? Are you improving or not? This is actually the activity. This is more the size, the activity, and this is the demography. I like this picture a lot because I know a lot of community managers that usually say that community is not about getting people inside, it's about retaining people because I am losing a lot each month. This is the people, the big blue, this one, shows how many people joined the community. It was 1 year ago, 1.5 years ago, 2 years ago, 3 years ago. You know, this is the hype moment when you grow that high. But this bar downside is the people that is still nowadays active in the community in this 6 months. So you can see things like from 6 months now to since to this one, I think it's more clear when you see the numbers. 290 people join there and start contributing there. In these latest 6 months, only 44 of them is still contributing, has made a contribution. That's retention. That's the demography of your company, of your community, or whatever. And you can do the same chart for whatever data source you can imagine. Mailing list, issue tracking systems, whatever. You can measure that. If you go, for example, in this one is TypeScript, okay? The course is not that long developed, but I think this is jQuery. You see things like, okay, for example, 4 years ago, 34 people, and only one is still active. This means how many knowledge is your community losing? Because these are the people that have been contributing for a long time in the community. Okay, you can play also with things like, for example, inclusive. When you play with data about inclusiveness, this is the people that has submitted a pull request. People that wants to, I think this is going to be better for your code. And this is the real people that has, from that people, that his code has been accepted, or her code has been accepted. You know that? It's like, okay, probably my community is not that inclusive because I am abandoning a lot of commits. You can measure that kind of thing. Thank you. I almost finished it. So this is withers.io. And this is the last one. This is the bitter.io is based on a platform we have built during the last, I said, 15 years. So it's almost old school code. You can go there and play with that. It's Python based, a lot of Python scripts playing together to build that kind of stuff. So an Angular for the latest UI. But since I think it's half 6 months or something like that, we start to migrate to something new, more based on nowadays technologies about NoSQL, Elasticsearch, and a lot of things that is called Grimoire Lab. Grimoire Lab is a project, it's again an open source, free, libre open source software. You can play with that for free. And now we are supporting taking measure about GitHub issue pull request, Baxilla, Gerrit, Jira, Mailman, Stack Overflow, and so we are going to add things like Meetup, Asbot, Media Wiki, and things like that. I'm going to show you one example of the things we are doing with this. Let me check here. I think this is okay. This is kind of stuff we are building now. This is, how many of you know OpenStack? Do you know what? But for the people that doesn't know that, it's an pure open source cloud solution to build whatever thing you want on that. That is being used by companies and provided by companies like Red Hat, IBM, all these kind of people. And this is the activity in the project. The project is something, well, this is for the last year. You can have, you go to the address, I will share the address in Twitter. We have the data for the 5 years of the project. It's no more than 5 years project, and now they have something like 3,000 people contributing. Okay, it's not a bad number. So for the last year, they have like 3,000 people contributing to the project. So, okay, it's good. They have like 48 projects internally, developing the whole solution, projects for managing identity, the project solutions, whatever, and this is the activity more or less for all of the people. And all of these things can be measured, because again, it's open source, you can play with the data. And we can see things like, for example, where the people lives. Because we know the time zone where the contribution has been made. Okay, we can make some adjustment now in terms of, okay, if it's the zero area, probably it's Europe, North Africa, they don't have that area. But then we know clearly how many people from India they have in the project. One of the things here is also we have to identify which companies are participating. And this is the key point about diversity. One of the key points here about diversity to talk about, okay, I know many of you don't like this pie chart, but if you go here for the last year, if you look who are the number of companies doing the 50% of the code, you have a clear view. These ones, okay? So Mirantis, HP, Red Hat, IBM, and Rackspace are doing the 50% of the code. The unknown people is people that this has not cannot be aligned to a company, but if you go there, it's like, okay, this is the people, the real companies that are behind this project. If you can compare that with any other solutions, then you have a key metric. It's this, how secure I am if I take this project that the project is not going to death, right? Because if people like HP, Red Hat, IBM are behind the project in that huge part, it's important. If only one of them, only one is behind the project, the risk is higher, right? You take that decision. I have a joke that sometimes I went to a WordPress meeting in Madrid. The people was discussing about which WordPress plugin should I use for translation. And one of the guys said, okay, I have a very easy metric. If there is developed by one guy in Russia, I'm not going to use it. And I was, why? Because if a Russian guy gets a Russian girlfriend, then the project is not going to be maintained anymore. It's a metric, okay. It was her decision, his decision, but it was nice. And you can filter by the data. You can see things like, okay, I want to know in which projects, for example, Red Hat is involved. So I can, well, okay. Sometimes it's IT, HP, Mirantis, Red Hat. So everything is going to change now. So I can see things like, okay, they are working in this project. These are the people. This is where they live from. This is the evolution over time, and this is even the real commits they are using. And we are doing this for each data source you can imagine, okay? So that's what's my part, talking about metrics. I don't want to bore you a lot about numbers, so I think I have tried to do as much examples as possible. But I am open to questions, so thank you very much, and let's keep talking. Oh, Italo, make it easier, right?
Okay. Your metrics are very much focused on development. Mm-hmm. And development is not the only metric that you have to measure when you measure a community. Mm-hmm. What about adding something, because for instance, our community is in over 100 countries. LibreOffice is available in 110 linguistic versions, and some of them are quite, I would say, niche. We have LibreOffice in 11 Zulu dialect, which is a problem because it's a problem to reach the people that live in Zulu countries. They don't have, they don't have computers. The network comes after the computer. So we are willing to work with you. What about adding this kind of metrics? And please do not think that marketing people are tweaking metrics. We are using metrics. and we would like to have that metrics to promote the projects, because communication is very important and is not enough leverage in open source.
Thank you very much, Italo, for the question, and sorry if I have been misunderstood, that marketing people are only taking the first level metrics. They should start by something. This is like, that slide was about, there are other things you can use, right? About, we are software development oriented. That's one of the key points about the experience of the company. We're starting by measuring how software is being developed. One of the things we learned in, and I think I have in one slide there, here. One of the things we learned is that development is not only going to GitHub or Git and releasing code, as you said. It's about people that wants to review the code and make things like, okay, I want a Sulu translation, how to do that? And that is being discussed everywhere. Maybe in Discord, in the mailing list, in the IRC, we can measure that. And we also, people sometimes document the code or document how the development has been done. One of the things that is key for us, for the development, is how to profile people in all of these kind of things. One of the, I give you a very clear example. We have a Spanish open source project with cloud computing that is Open Nebula. And usually you go there and say, okay, who are the people that are contributing to the project? That is one guy has done a lot of commits in the past and now is decreasing. So if you think nowadays, you will say, okay, this guy is no one in the community. Because, okay, no activity in the JIT, no more activity in the issue tracking system, so maybe it's not. If you go to the mailing list, you see that he started talking in the mailing list and now he's talking a lot. You know what? He's the CEO of the company behind the project. So probably he doesn't have time for that. If you don't have the whole picture, you cannot measure and have an idea who are the people or what the people doing, because you are only seeing one small piece that is code. And I will tell you, open source and software development is more than code. Code is only how you picture that in an algorithm. But communities around open source are very different, and I quite agree with you, and that's our spin. I don't know if I have answered your question or not, but I have tried.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Altre domande? Okay, I have one question for you.
Yeah.
Okay. You applied those metrics and those measurements to, you know, open source projects or code. Have you tried to apply the same architecture, the same, you know, approach also to project that has nothing to do with code and open source?
Yeah, one of the things that I think I have here has been doing lately in this one. It's not about code at all. It's about how we manage things in Mozilla Spanish, for example. When someone joins the community or wants to help, what we do is, okay, go to GitHub, make an account, and we are going to manage things through tasks. That is actually in GitHub are issues. We don't matter about the semantics here. It's about how to manage people doing things. And one of the things, okay, now we're starting to do that, is, okay, we want to measure things about how people are solving these tasks. Do they have enough information? So let's start measuring something. I think that's the key point of our metrics. It's not about measuring things. Okay, we need to have some kind of strategy about, okay, we need some measures to know where we are. And this is the first point. It's about, okay, this is the areas we work, like administration, news, localization, about people that want to translate things, not code at all, it's just translation. And these are the people joined, this is where they live from, and this is the issues opening. And so, okay, now we have a picture. Next step, for the next 3 months, we want to reduce the time for people to solve the things. Probably providing more information. Okay, we think that providing more information is going to be useful. Let's provide information and measure again in 3 months. So now we can take decisions about, okay, probably if people are not solving that well the things, probably information was not enough. Let's talk about next step. So you can keep improving on that. This is the kind of approaches. You can do the same thing, for example, in Meetup. One simple question. We measure activity in meetups so easily. And when you manage a meetup in Spain, probably in Italy is the same, especially when they are free, it's like, okay, you make the announcement and 200 people register for the meetup. Cool. You go there, you reserve a big place, and then you end like, okay, only 100 people appears. So people in the community start to think, okay, probably I'm doing something wrong because only one half of the people are probably coming. And that's an issue. When you take the measure about all the meetups in Madrid, for example, we discovered that if you make a free meetup, usually the 50% of the people only the 50% of the people appear. So the question is there really a problem if everybody happens everywhere? Because probably there is no problem. The reality is that if you make it free, only 50% of the people will come. So take a decision. Make it not free. How many people start to come? Then you can measure again. You can see things like, okay, more people are coming. Or maybe you take decisions about, okay, I'm going to make a venue only for 50, and I'm going to say that I have 100 people that can register. And the thing is, if you do that, you are going to have a crowd thing. The good thing is for the next picture, people will say, okay, that was crowd, so I'm going to go this time. So you can make that kind of decision, measuring.
You can do A/B testing on community decisions.
Yeah. That's the key point about metrics. It's not about measuring itself. Measuring, I would say that because it's not useful in taking metrics only by taking metrics. You have to think about the strategy, as Alessio has said. You have to take decisions about A/B testing, and you can play with the data from there. That's the key point, I think. More questions?
You already answered my question.
Thank you.
So my question is about how do you read the data for the next step, or the next, how do you read, I don't know, are losing people? You mentioned about the first active contributors, and how do you take the next?
Take
the next action. How do you read your data? Your Amazon, a lot of data, okay, good, but how do you craft, you create your strategy using this data?
Now, one of the things, first of all, probably is me. the first thing is, that's right, take a decision about what's going to be the strategy on my community. If it's getting more people, probably the first level metric is going to be enough. The third thing is when you are going to do it repeatedly, by month, by quarter. Usually managers want that information in a big picture by quarter. So we provide reports quarter by quarter or month by month for the specific things. Because the first thing when we start working on this is, well, let's do a dashboard. When we show the dashboard to someone, it's like, oh, nice, they start to play, and then they start to think about new questions. I want to know how many people from this area of my country come here. Okay, then that's a specific key. That's something that's very specific, though. So we build the report based on that. And we can help on that. Okay, if you want more people, then do this. If you want more people contributing in the mailing list, then do that. For example, now we are working with Zen. Do you know the Zen project? It's a virtualization project, collaborated with Linux kernel and things like that. And the code review, they are doing code review in the mailing list. So people submit a patch to the kernel. It's like, okay, I think this is going to be better. And then they discuss in the mailing list. And last semester, they say, okay, we want to know if we are doing it fast enough. And that was the first question. How fast are we accepting patches in the kernel? So if you go and you think about, I have to measure a mailing list, people discussing, talking in the, and putting tags about, this is solved, it's not that easy. So we provide a repurposed initial thing about, this is what is happening. And the second step was, okay, it seems there is not that issue because we have in the middle terms of the one thing like, okay, we want to release like 2 weeks, let's say that. And it was, okay, we are releasing last 2 weeks, so we are okay. Now we want to improve, so we are going to take a decision, the A/B testing, and then we are measuring again. I'm measuring in that specific thing. The dashboard is for free. You can go there, play with the data. Make the right questions is the smart movement, I think. Thank you very much, because I think we are out of time.
Yeah, but you know, you're a kind of river of words, so it's incredible to listen to you about.
No, please don't say that. Thank you very much.